Blackstone Audio presents The Center of the World by Thomas Van Essen. This book is read by Simon Vance, Paul Michael, Cassandra Campbell, Vanessa Benjamin, and Gildart Jackson. For Bob, with love. No man ever painted or ever will paint well anything but what he has early and long seen, early and long felt, and early and long loved. John Ruskin, Modern Painters. Here his intention seems to have been one of private gratification rather than preparation for a more developed work. Anne Cholmondeley and Ian Worrall, Turner and the Human Figure, Studies of Contemporary Life, discussing Turner's Sheet of Erotic Figure Subjects, circa 1805. It is no discredit for Trojans and well-grieved Achaeans to suffer long anguish for a woman like that. Homer, Iliad, translated by Anne Carson. 1856. She was no doubt the most wicked of women. They were the most wicked of pictures. I knew Ruskin was right and that they ought to be consigned to the fire. "Wernham," he said, "I have been entrusted with the memory of England's greatest painter. These images are the products of a diseased mind. We must destroy them. If we do not, the world will not remember Turner as the transcendent genius of his age." He instructed the boy to gather some old lumber and kindle a fire in the brickyard behind the gallery. Ruskin said that he himself could not bear to see these sketches burnt, although he knew it was his duty. He was quite distraught, and asked me, as a special favour to him, if he could excuse himself, and if I would place the offending material in the flames. Ruskin withdrew, and one by one I let the sheets fall into the fire. Most were drawings on paper, some were oil sketches on canvas. A mournful black smoke rose into the sky. I was not sad to see most of this material go. I had been to Paris when I was young, and being no better than most young men, I had seen material of this sort for sale on the banks of the Seine. Most of what I burnt was no better than that. But there was a set of notebooks that gave me pause. They seemed a study for a painting of some evil queen of antiquity. Ruskin said she was Jezebel. I did not say so, but I believe she was Helen. She was more beautiful than I can say. More wicked, too, no doubt. One by one I placed the sheets from the notebook on the fire and watched her disappear in the flames. It was as if I had cast her into hell myself. After the last piece was burnt and the fire extinguished, I went inside. Ruskin offered me a glass of sherry, which I gratefully accepted. There was a look of suffering on his face. I had done him, he said, a great service. I said it was nothing, but my looks must have given the lie to my protestation. I am sure we did what was needful. But I think of her often during the day. And by night, she haunts my brain.
1. In order that I should feel the pangs of hell most fiercely, Providence in its wisdom has decreed that I should taste heaven before I die. This is, to be sure, a peculiarly English heaven, but it is hard to conceive of a French or Italian one half so comfortable or so pleasing. The presiding genius of the place is, of course, Lord Egremont, of whom you have heard much. He is a most remarkable personage. I've spent only a few minutes in his company, yet I have felt the nature of the man in my bones. It is difficult to explain or account for. He exudes a sense of mastery so complete that he need not exert it. He is all kindness and welcome, but one knows by a kind of instinct that he is quick to anger, and that his wrath, when unleashed, is most terrible. He takes, I think, a silent delight in knowing that all those around him live in fear, although, in spite of that, he appears a delightful old gentleman of the gruff, old-fashioned school. He is almost 80, yet as active as a healthy man of 50. Every morning after breakfast he buttons on his leather gaiters and goes out to inspect some part of his vast agricultural enterprise. It is curious to stand in one of the drawing-rooms here and look out upon the park and see this English Maecenas making his way across the great lawn, his favourite brown spaniels following close behind. Behind the hounds comes a boy leading his horse and other functionaries and factotums, all waiting on his merest nod or grunt. One's only obligation while a guest here, as near as I can make out, is to be agreeable and not to get in Lord Egremont's way. Those guests who delight in the hunt join his lordship when he rides. Those more peaceably inclined are given the freedom of the house and the grounds. There is much to do.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.